Today, what we're going to go through is something called Casimir's trick. So what we did last time, just to recap, was we showed how a spinner transforms under Lorentz and under parity transforms, and we use this to construct these four types of quantities: scalar, pseudoscalars, vectors, and axial vectors or pseudo-vectors. Then we solve Maxwell's equations by introducing the four potential, a mu, and came up with a photon wave function, which of course has a polarization vector. We said that this polarization vector has got two allowed states, and that was the reason it's only two instead of 2s plus one, which you'd normally sort of expect to give you three states for a spin one particle, is because we've got a massless photon, so we can't have a transverse polarization. So, and that only applies for massless spin one particles. What we'll see next week when we do W and Z bosons is that you get something different. You get three polarization states. Then we went through the Feynman rules for QED. Since we're doing spinners now, we have to worry about the order. And so we said that when we go through one of these QED diagrams, we go backwards along a fermion line in order to make sure that we get the right order for the spinners. And we added this new anti-symmetrization rule because we're dealing with fermions, so we have to have an anti-symmetric wave function. And then finally, we used the Feynman rules to derive amplitudes for simple QED processors, the one, of course, being electron muon scattering, right? So we looked at E mu minus goes to E mu minus, right, which had a diagram, T-channel diagram, that looked like this, where we have the muon coming in here, and the muon here, and the electron here, and the electron there, and then a photon there. And we wrote down the, use this diagram to calculate the amplitude. And this is where we're going to start this lecture. So last time we wrote down our, we derived our amplitude as GE squared all over P1 minus P3 squared. And then we had these spinner terms here. So U bar 3 gamma mu, and that coupled to U1, where these, of course, are now the spinners of the incoming electron and outgoing electron coupling through this vertex factor here, which gives us a gamma mu. And then we had on the other side U bar, I won't write the brackets, I'll just use a suffix here, U bar 4 gamma mu, and that one we'll put down because remember the propagator has this G mu nu factor, so that's why this one ends up at the bottom, times U 2. So these are the terms, and each one of these square bracket terms here corresponds to a line in the diagram, right? So we have one line here and one line here. Now, but of course we went through them backwards against the fermion arrow. So now, of course, what we want to do is we want to calculate the matrix amplitude, the matrix element squared, the amplitude squared, because that's what we need for Fermi's golden rule. The matrix element by itself is no good to us. We've got to take the modulus of it. And we say modulus because, of course, it can be a complex number. So when we do this, what we're going to end up with is this term here, of course, is going to be squared, because what we're actually going to be doing is we're going to be evaluating this expression here, m dagger m. So this term here is simply going to be squared because it's going to be repeated twice and it's all real. This is the magnitude of a four vector squared, so it's going to be real, and that's GE squared, so it's going to be real. So this is just this thing squared. And then we have these things here, complex conjugate transposed, multiplied by the originals. So this is now our amplitude squared, where we have complex conjugate transpose multiplied by this. Now, if you look at these terms, what we've got here is we've got a spinner multiplied by a four vector multiplied by a spinner, right? So these terms are essentially one-by-one matrices, and so these terms will actually commute, right? It doesn't matter what the order of these square bracket terms is, they're going to commute with each other as long as we move the whole square bracket around, right? So we're free to pair these guys up as we like without any trouble. And in fact, you can see this because the way I'm going through it is, this is the typical way I write it out as M dagger M. The book uses a slightly different order. They do M, M dagger, and you'll see that we get the same result. It doesn't matter the fact that I started off with these square brackets a different way. Within the square brackets, though, you've got to be very careful, right? Because these things are not scalars. So what we can do is we can rearrange these things. So I'm going to rearrange and group this bracket with this bracket here. And so we're going to have a term here that we're going to call G that comes from pairing up this guy with its complex conjugate. So I'm just going to, I'll write this out. So G is just U3 bar gamma mu U1 dagger, and this thing is U3 bar gamma mu U1. Right, so I'm just pairing up these two guys together. Now, if I write out this in longhand, so I'm now going to take this term here, right, and I'm going to take the complex, the Hermitian conjugate, and I'm going to put it into this term. So when I transpose part of this is going to flip the ordering of these matrices, right? So if I'm writing this out now and putting in the transpose into each of these, then I have to reverse the order. So this here is going to be equal to U1 dagger gamma mu dagger U3 bar dagger. But if I write out this, remember this was the bar notation, the adjoint is just the spinner, is the complex conjugate of the spinner written. So what I've got here, so this is the complex, okay, so U3 bar is equal to U3 Hermitian conjugate times gamma zero. Right, this was our definition of what an adjoint spinner is. So here, U3 dagger is going to be just U3 times gamma zero dagger. Right? So what have I done here? Why have I got that the other way around? So what I did was I skipped a step, and that caused me to make a mistake. Okay, so what I should do is I should write out this first before, write out the adjoint form here so I don't mess up. So this is U3 dagger gamma zero, so that's just U3 bar, then gamma mu U1, and I'm taking the Hermitian conjugate of that, right? So I've written out this adjoint spinner in full form here. Right? So if I do that, now what I have to do is I have to reverse the ordering of these guys. So this now becomes U1 dagger times gamma mu dagger times gamma zero dagger, and then U3, right? So I'm just putting in the Hermitian conjugate into the terms of the bracket, which flips the ordering of the terms because it involves a transpose. Yep, everybody happy with that? Okay, so if I look at these things now, there's two identities on your list of identities that I gave you on Thursday, right? One of these is that gamma zero squared is equal to the identity. So what I can do is I can stick in a gamma zero term here, squared, right? Because all I'm doing is just sticking in the identity if I put in a gamma zero squared term, right? And here, I have this other result, which is gamma zero dagger is just equal to gamma zero, right? Because if you remember, these are Hermitian matrices. So the complex conjugate transpose, the Hermitian conjugate, is just equal to the inverse of the matrix. And since gamma zero squared is equal to I here, this is its own inverse. Right? So this thing now becomes U1 dagger, gamma zero, gamma mu dagger, and now gamma zero, U3, right? So I've inserted in these two terms because it's just inserting the identity, and this guy is just equal to gamma zero, so I've put that back to gamma zero. So if I look at this term now, this is just U1 adjoint, right? I've got my adjoint spinner back here. Here I've got U3, and this is what we write as gamma U, gamma mu adjoint, right? So this is how we write an adjoint 4x4 matrix, right? Here now we've got two gamma zero factors, and we write that as gamma mu bar. But here I've been dealing with gamma mu. Had I, in fact, generalized it, and rather than having gamma mu here, just had any series of gamma matrices, right? It doesn't matter what it is here, right? Because all I've left this as is I've just left this as gamma mu Hermitian conjugate. So anything here, it doesn't matter what it is, all I've done is I've left it as a Hermitian conjugate, and then I've added gamma zeros on either side. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to generalize this and say that if I started here with U3 bar, and then we're just saying this is some gamma matrix, right? In our case here, it's gamma mu, but it doesn't have to be. I mean, it could be any sort of a series of gamma matrices times U1. That when we take the Hermitian conjugate of that, what we end up with is U1 bar gamma 1 bar times U3. Right, where we've defined this gamma 1 bar here where that's our definition of what this bar means for the gamma matrix. So this is a general result here. I can replace gamma mu with whatever we want, which is will become important later on because you don't always just get gamma mu here. You can get gamma mu times gamma 5. Comes up when we start doing weak interactions next week. Okay, so any questions so far? It's just simple, but maybe not particularly pleasant mathematics. Okay, so going back to this term here now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite this. So with our using what we've just written out here, right? So I'm going to rewrite this with a bar in it. So this here now is just this term, it's difficult trying to get the right illumination for here. So all I've done now is I've rewritten my G term but with the result that we just calculated, right? So I end up with a U3 here, a U1 bar, and then this is gamma 1 bar. And to keep things general, rather than this specific example, I will call this gamma 2. Right? So now I can look at this term here, right? Where I've got a U3 and a U3 bar. But by itself, this is not particularly useful because this comes out of this amplitude squared, but the amplitude squared depends on the particle spin states, right? So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to sum over all the possible spin states for particle 3, right? Now, the reason for doing this is that if I sum over all the possible spin states for particle 3, I'm going to have all possible solutions to the Dirac equation, because remember, U3 here is a solution to the Dirac equation. And so what I'm going to end up with is a term that looks like this. So sum over the spin of 3 of U3 U bar 3, right? And you remember, this was a solution to the Dirac equation. And when we do this, what we're going to find is that when we sum over all the possible spin states here, we're going to get what we had for the Dirac equation. Right? Now, this is a result that you'll be proving in the assignments. It's called the completeness relation. But if you sum over all, if you're summing over all possible spin state solutions to the Dirac equation, what you're going to end up with is essentially the Dirac equation. Because remember, this guy here came from the solution of this equation. Right? And so if we're summing over all possible solutions here, we're going to get back to the original Dirac equation. So as long as we're adding over all possible spin states, what we end up with is P3 slash plus M3C, where if you remember, this slash notation here means gamma mu P3 mu. Right, that was our Dirac slash notation that we introduced last time. Okay, any questions about that? This result is probably not quite obvious, but it should be hopefully after you've looked at it for your assignment.
What do you mean by all possible spin states, like spin 0, 1/2?
But spin 0 isn't a possible spin state, right? So what this means is, so for this case, what it is you've only got two. So in this case, you've only got two spin states, right? And which is plus a half or minus a half, or really it's helicity states, so left-handed and right-handed. If you look at where these spinners came from on Tuesday, these spinners came from the solution of this equation, right? So it if you go back and look at that, but this is a problem on the assignment, right? So you'll have a chance to think about it. It's not entirely obvious, but really, I mean, this is what I mean. It was solving this equation that gave us these spinner states, right? So when we summing over all the solutions of U bar, yeah, you'll end up with this Dirac relationship again.
So is P slash 3 a
4
by 4 matrix?
Okay, yes. Yeah, and this is the identity.
4 by 4 matrix plus just a constant. Should that be like a 4 by 4 identity matrix times that?
Yes. Yeah, no, this was something I mentioned last time, but it's easy to sort of forget. Everywhere where you just have something that looks like it's a scalar quantity, if you're adding that to something that's a 4x4 matrix here, that means that you are putting in, there's implicitly assumed there an identity matrix. So, I mean, if I was writing it out there, then, yeah, I would write out I4. Times that, but that is a piece of notation, and that's actually they use it in the book. So I've left that sort of notation in. That it's just assumed that you're multiplying by the identity matrix. Right, and so this here is a 4x4 matrix, right? Because you've got different indices on each of the spinners.
Okay.
Okay, so because of this completeness relationship, which you will, you'll have a chance to look at more detail in the assignment, this, as long as I'm summing over all the spins, so here I'm just summing over all the spins of particle 3, this guy here gives me the completeness relationship, and so now what I have is I have u bar 1, gamma 1 bar, and then this now becomes P3 slash plus M3C, and then gamma 2 U1, right? So this is the summing over all the spin states of particle 3. So I end up with this relationship here. And now, to simplify things, what I'm going to do is, if I look at this term here in the middle, I'm going to call that, this is a 4x4 matrix, right? Because it's a 4x4 matrix multiplied by a 4x4 matrix multiplied by another 4x4 matrix. So this term here is a 4x4 matrix. And so what I'm going to write this down is, where Q here is equivalent to gamma 1 bar P3 slash plus right, so I'm just defining a 4x4 matrix to keep things simple. So now what I can do is, so I've got this term now summing over the spin states of particle 3. So what I'm going to do now is write in the indices for this multiplication, right? Because here we've got a spinner. This isn't a joint spinner, but it's nevertheless a spinner. This is a spinner, and here we've got a 4x4 matrix. So I can write this as U1 bar I, Qij, U1j, right? Where this is just how you write down the multiplication of a spinner with a vector, a spinner with a matrix with another spinner, right? With implicit, you know, summation over, summation convention applies, so we're summing over repeated indices. Now, once I've got it written like this, I should now also sum over all the spins of particle 1, right? Now, the reason I want to start doing that is because, as you can see, if I can bring these two guys together, while I'm also summing over all the spin states of particle 1, then the moment I can get these two guys together, I'm immediately going to have another completeness relation, right? So what I'm going to do now is sum over all the spins of 1 and sum over all the spins of 3. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to reverse the order of multiplication here. So I'm going to take this guy over to here. And when I do that, if I flip the order of the multiplication, I also have to flip the order of the indices for these two guys here. So what I'm going to end up with is summing over all spins 1. So I've got Qij just as I had before. And now I'm treating these two guys as if they were a 4x4 matrix. So what I'm going to have is U1 bar U, but now J times I. Right, so that's just matrix multiplication with summation convention. I'm flipping the order of these two guys, and that means I have to reverse the indices. So, if I look at these, what I've got here, this of course is now, because I'm summing over all the spins, this is just the completeness relationship again. So I can replace this with, but now it's for particle one, so I can replace this now, but with p slash one, m1c. So it's the same thing I have here, but for particle one. I'll write this down as a single sum, but I'm summing over spins of one and spins of three. And this now is just now, if I take this Q inside here, right, then this just becomes a trace. So this is equal to Q times P slash P slash 1 plus M1C I, right? And so this term here, if I've got repeated indices, that just means summing up the trace of this matrix, right? So what I'm doing is I'm putting this matrix inside the bracket here, and that gives me a trace. Right? Because what this is saying is I have to multiply these two guys together and then sum, because there's two indices that were repeated. If this was a normal matrix multiplication, this would be ij, jk. And that, of course, would then give me a 4x4 matrix. But because this I is repeated, what it means is that if I multiply these two together, instead of then ending up with an I and a K, which would mean the whole matrix, I ended up with this repeated II, which means the trace. Right? So this expression here is just the trace of this matrix. Is everybody happy with that? Right, I mean, I think the one part that is probably not clear, or at least it wasn't when I did it, was this completeness, when I did it for the first time as an undergrad, was this completeness relationship here is not particularly obvious. Now, rather than spend half an hour of the lecture going through the detailed explanation of that, this is something that you can tackle yourselves. And in fact, it's on the assignment due at the end of this week, right? So if you do have trouble with that, then come and see me, and we can go through it in detail. But once you've got the completeness relationship down, then the rest of this should follow pretty clearly. Yeah? No? Any questions? There's just shell-shocked silence. are you grasping where this is coming from, or have I? Are you happy with this? Anybody? Wow. Okay. Well, if you have problems, let me know. Right. I mean, I think the trickiest part is this completeness relationship. The rest, I'm hoping, is relatively straightforward, and the completeness relationship will be something that you'll be doing on the assignment. So if you do have problems, then you'll know to come and talk with me. So this is Casimir's trick, right? This is the mathematical trick that makes Feynman diagrams, while still incredibly hard to evaluate, actually possible for mere mortals. And so what we have is that if we've got this term here and we sum it over all the spin states of both particles, because remember, we've got particles 1 and particles 3 here, so it's not the whole amplitude squared, it's just part of it. But if we sum over all the spins for this part of the expression here, what we end up with is the trace of a matrix, right? So here, if you substitute Q back in, I rubbed out the definition, but if you substitute Q back in here, this was our definition of Q, gamma 1 bar, P3 plus M3, gamma 2. So we put in back our definition for Q, and this whole term here just turns into the evaluation of a trace of this matrix, which now explains why on the sheet I gave you on Thursday, there were all these matrix element identities. I don't know if I've still got the sheet here, right? But if you notice, did everybody pick one up last Thursday? Was it? Okay. Anybody else need one? So these identities that we had, if you notice, there's an awful lot of them with towards the end that are traces of gamma matrices, right? So from 16 onwards, we're worried about evaluating the trace of gamma matrices. And this is the reason why, because we can, anytime we have one of these sort of fermion lines, so remember this structure comes from an external line, vertex, and an incoming line, and another external line, right? So this is where the structure comes from, which of course occurs in all the Feynman diagrams, and this just turns into the evaluation of a trace when we sum over all spins. Now, if we're not summing over all spins, so there are some experiments out there which look at polarized situations. So for example, if you were really interested in the structure function of the proton and worked at HERA, where they were colliding electrons and protons, then there, in fact, they did a series of experiments with polarized electron beams. And so in that case, you weren't summing over all the spins. You had a particular spin state of the electron, or it was like 80% polarized. So of course, it wasn't quite as easy as having a single spin state of the electron, but it wasn't a sum over all spins. It was more of one spin than the other by a large fraction. And so when you were dealing with that, you would not want to use Casimir's trick here, but the advantage you'd have there is you'd know what the spinners were for the electron state, because we came up with the solutions to the Dirac equation. You'd actually put in the spinners for the electron, and then of course you'd evaluate this term using the particular spin states. What Casimir's trick says is that if we don't care about the spins, which is the case in 90% of particle physics, right? Where all we're doing is we're just taking unpolarized particles and colliding them. So the LHC, for example, doesn't have polarized proton beams. They're unpolarized proton beams. LEP was unpolarized electron-positron beams. Tevatron, unpolarized proton-antiproton beams. So if you're dealing with unpolarized cross-sections and interactions, then you want to sum over all the spins. Yeah, in fact, we'll turn this into an average by dividing by the total number of spins. But if you don't care about the spin states, then you need to use Casimir's trick to evaluate things to get the proper cross-section. And this is an extremely powerful mathematical tool because it's collapsing all of these complex spinners and 4x4 matrices into just the trace of something which still looks complicated, but with the help of these identities, we can split and make a lot simpler, because if you've got the trace of two things like A plus B, then that's just equal to the trace of A plus the trace of B. So what we'll do when we come to evaluate these things is expand out these brackets, and then we'll have the sum of traces of individual terms. And that is really simple to evaluate if you've got a series of identities like this, right? So it's still not trivial, but we'll do an example. Well, we're in the middle of doing an example, right? So this is the electron muon scattering. So this was the matrix element we started with. We expanded it out to this guy. So this is coming back to where we were. And we're now going to evaluate all of these terms here. So we're going to deal with the unpolarized scattering cross-section, and that is why we're going to use Casimir's trick, because we're summing over all the spins. So we aren't going to care about the particular cross-section. And are these things repeated? Okay, no. So in this case, we've got gamma mu and gamma nu, right? Because if we look at these guys here, we have the repeated indices, we're taking one, these are repeated indices, so there's a mu here and a mu here, and then the complex conjugate has got a repeated index, but it's going to be a different repeated index because we want to sum over these guys and then take the complex conjugate, and so that means that this is a different sum from that, right? So we have different indices, yeah? Right, because this means the sum over all of these things where you've got gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, and this means the sum over this terms where you've got gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3. Right? If we had all these indices the same, then it would mean the sum over this where you've got gamma 0, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, which is not the same. Right? So these indices are different from these indices because we've got a sum over these and sum over these independently before we multiply. So when we collect these terms together, what we're going to end up with is a term. So actually, when I was writing this down, I didn't put that in. I made that mistake. No, hang on a minute. And that should be gamma. No, that's right, yes, gamma nu, and then gamma nu. There we go. So I should have done that there. So what we're going to do is if we look at this guy with this guy, then what we've got is we've got gamma 1 is equal to this. So this is equal to gamma 1. And this guy is equal to gamma 2. And so what we're going to get, and we've got particle 3 and particle 2 here. So where this is going to give us is, so these two terms here are going to give us the trace of, so it's gamma 1 bar, so this is gamma 0, gamma mu bar, times, and then here we get So if you remember Casimir's trick here, so I've got gamma 1 and I've got gamma 2 and I've got particle 3 and then particle 1. So it's gamma 1 bar, particle 3, gamma 2, particle 1. So taking these, I've got gamma mu bar and then particle 1, which is just, particle 3, which is P3 slash plus M3C, and then gamma 2, which in this case is gamma nu P1 slash, right? So that's Casimir's trick on these two brackets. And then I'm going to do Casimir's trick on these two. Well, here gamma 1 is gamma mu with the index on the bottom. Right, and then I've got particle 4, so this is P4 slash plus M4C, and then I've got gamma 2, and then I've got particle 2. Everybody happy with that? Sorry, what have I done here? Pardon? Sorry. That's wrong. If you notice here, right, I have it correct with the indices on the bottom. Sorry, this is from cutting and pasting LaTeX expressions and then not altering them. So yeah, you're right. These ones here, these indices should be moved to the bottom, right? Because they come, these two expressions here are correct, and then when I cut and pasted this expression to generate this expression, I changed the twos and threes, but I didn't move the mu's down to the bottom. So that's my mistake. right? So these guys should be down at the bottom here. Now, the reason that these things don't have bars on the top is because the identity here for gamma matrices is that if I've got a product of gamma matrices, which I'm taking the adjoint of, then all that happens here is I can reverse the order and get rid of the adjoint. So what that means here is that if I've got a single gamma matrix, then this guy here, I can just remove the adjoint from. And it doesn't make any difference. So this is our matrix element squared for electron muon scattering. We ended up with these brackets. Casimir's trick allows us to pair these up and turn them into a product of two traces. And so now what we're going to do is we're going to take one of these things and expand it out and calculate the trace. Now, before we get to that, what we have to do here is this, of course, we can only do this expansion if we are, because what we're wanting is we're wanting to take the average matrix element over all possible spin combinations. Now, we're talking about electron muon scattering, so we've got E mu going to E mu. So if you look at the initial spin states, right, the electron has got two, the muon has got two, so we've got four possible spin states, right? Because when we do Casimir's trick, this implies a sum over all spin states of the two particles. So since we've got two spin states for particle one and two spin states for particle two, that means that we've got four possible spin states. And so the sum over those four spin states is what gives us these traces. So, but what we want is we don't want the sum over the spin states, we want the average over the spin states. And so that means that we have to add a quarter in here because there's four initial spins. And when we do Casimir's trick, we do the sum over the spins, not the average over the spins. And what we want is the average. So since the sum is given by this, and there are four spin states, we have to add a 1 over 4 factor in order to convert that sum into an average. Okay, so this is where this factor of 1 over 4 comes from. So now, if we take this first guy and we expand it out, so this here is going to be equal to, well, what I'm going to have here is gamma mu P3 slash gamma nu P1 slash. So that's going to be one term. And since the trace of A plus B is just the trace of A plus the trace of B, I can simplify this down to gamma mu P3 slash gamma nu P1 slash. Right, so that's going to be my first term. Then what I'm going to have is there's going to be two terms which have got a gamma and a slashed P term and then another gamma, but then they're going to have a mass term. So yeah, I've messed up there, haven't I? Because I've started talking about electron-electron scattering. Is that right? Oh no, that's right, yeah, because 1 and 3 here, okay. So, getting myself confused. So one, particle one and particle three, one is the incoming electron, the other one is the outgoing electron. So these guys both have the same mass. Sorry, that was what was confusing me. So what I will do is I will replace M3 and M1 with ME. And ME, because these are the same in both cases. So what I'm going to have is I'm going to have a gamma mu P3 gamma nu ME, and I'm also going to have a gamma mu ME gamma nu P1, right? So I can take the ME factor out of that, and what I will end up with is the trace of gamma mu p3 slash gamma nu plus the trace of gamma mu p1 slash, and then all the time multiplied by MEC. Right? So that's going to take care of the ones where I have a gamma mu, a p, and an m, and then the other one with a single m. And then finally, I've got one term left, which is the two when I've got both of these ME terms. And so this is going to give me gamma mu ME, gamma nu ME. Well, of course, these are scalars. Well, they're identities, so they can commute out. And so what this will give me is a final term that will be the trace of gamma mu, gamma nu, MEC squared. Okay, so this is just expanding out these brackets. The reason I do it in this complicated way rather than trying to write it out is because we're dealing with matrices here, and so the ordering is important. I can't just flip the ordering everywhere like you can with normal algebra. So it's a little bit more common. You've got to be a little bit more careful when expanding these things out. Okay, so now we can go and we can have a look at our sheet of identities, right? So this is just to save an inordinate amount of algebra. I mean, you can prove these identities if you have trouble believing them, but generally speaking, I mean, so you can go through this and do it, but for these sorts of things, we're going to be doing enough algebra without having to actually go through and start proving these from basic principles. So if I look at this sheet here, then what I have is I have the trace of the product of two gamma matrices, like this, is equal to the space-time metric g mu nu. There's actually a typo here that mu on the bottom should be a mu on the top, and this is identity 17. So we can solve this using identity 17 on the sheet. And then this guy, we can solve where we got here. Okay, so for these guys here, right, if I write this out, so if I take this term here and I write it out, what I've got is I've got the trace of gamma mu, and then p3 slash is going to be gamma lambda p3 lambda gamma mu, right? Now, this guy, of course, does not have a trace, so I can take this outside the brackets, because if you look on your identities, the second identity, number 2, tells you that if you've got trace of alpha times A, it's just alpha times the trace of A. So I can take this outside the brackets, and this now just becomes that. And if you look at your sheet, you will find that the trace number 15 tells you that the trace of an odd number of gamma matrices, which is what this is 0, right? And we can do exactly the same here. Remember, there's a gamma mu, a gamma 0, not gamma 0, a gamma, well, gamma lambda again, in here. And so we're going to end up with the product of three gamma matrices, and then, you know, this term outside the front. But the trace of the product of three gamma matrices is going to be 0. So that term is equal to 0, and this term is equal to 0. So we can forget about this whole term on the end. Right? So this one we've evaluated, this is just equal to g mu nu, the metric. This guy, I was trying to find the gamma matrix here. This guy we are going to expand out. And so what we get, right? So this guy we're going to expand out. So just like we did here, where once we've got a vector, vectors don't have traces, so we take those outside the trace here. So once we've got this vector outside the trace, this guy here is going to have another gamma Okay, so let's, well, we've got rid of this term here, so let's, so that term's gone to zero. And then this guy here now, we'll write this out. So we're going to get, this is going to be equal to the trace of gamma mu, and then let's say gamma lambda p3 lambda, gamma mu, and then gamma sigma p1 sigma. Did I choose the same? I did choose the same ones there, good. Okay, so these terms here, we can just take outside, right? It doesn't matter whether you put them at the front or the back, so I could put them at the front there. So this is equal to p3 lambda p1 sigma times the trace now of gamma mu, gamma lambda, gamma, oops, mu, gamma sigma, right? And unfortunately, this one is not so nice, because if we look at our sheet here, and we look at the trace of the product of four gamma matrices, and we end up with this again, sorry, no, it's number 18, and again, I messed up, the mu should be on the top, and not on the bottom. This guy here, so what we've got is P3 lambda P1 sigma, and this here is going to be times 4, and then we have this really horrible, nasty thing. So we've got G mu nu G lambda sigma minus G mu, oh, hang on a minute. Yeah, I'm going to have to, okay, minus G. Okay, so to fix this, what I've got here on the is mu nu lambda sigma, and of course my indices here are not quite the same way around. So every time there's a, if you've got the sheet in front of you, every time there's a nu, I have to replace that with a lambda. So this is g mu lambda, and then lambda sigma is the last two, so this is nu sigma. And then here I've got minus lambda nu, which is the first and third. So first and third is mu nu. And then I've got nu sigma, which is the second and fourth. So lambda sigma. And then plus, and I've got mu sigma, which is first and fourth. So that's mu, still mu sigma. And then I've got nu lambda here, which is the middle two, so that's lambda nu. Right, so all I did here was I took the identity from here, and then I've got a slightly different ordering of indices here, so I had to adapt that. Right, so now we have the fun of multiplying this through here. So of course, what we've got to do now is each of these metrics will operate on one of these vectors and alter the index. So here, when I'm multiplying, so I'm going to have a 4 out the front, and then g mu nu times this guy will just give me p3, and then mu up here, right? And this guy operating on here will give me P1, and then the sigma will turn into a nu up here. Minus, so here the mu nu, well, I'm going to have a g mu nu left over here because that's not operating on anything. And then the g lambda sigma will operate on this. So this will give me p3 sigma up here times p1 sigma down there. So this is just p3 dotted with p1. Right, remembering it's a four vector dot product. Right, because this will give me, so this metric here, we'll put this lambda up to here, and then I have P3 sigma, P1 sigma, and that's the dot product. Okay, so this gives me a dot product, and then this guy here, well, the what I'm going to end up with here is this P1 term will come up. So I'm going to end up with P1, and then, but because these things are the, so these indices are reversed, so this is why I'm doing a transpose of this to get these things the right way around, which is why the order is reversed. So this is going to be P1 mu, and then here I'm going to have P3 mu. Right, so you can see that evaluating these Feynman diagrams is, that's a real fun exercise in algebra. So here's what we get left with at the end of that. And so we've used these identities to evaluate this expression. So any questions on that, other than the fact that it's really tedious algebra? Right. I mean, it should hopefully not be challenging. At least this thing is just going through and using the identity and then multiplying these things through together. Okay, so at the end of this, we've evaluated this trace to be this expression here, right? So if I'm, what I'm doing now is if I stick, because of course we've got to forget this g mu nu me term. Right, and so we have this g mu nu me term, which goes along with this g mu nu p3 dot p1. Right, so this extra term comes from our second trace quantity that was not zero. So this trace evaluates to this. Now we are not going to go through all that algebra again, but we can use a shortcut. So for the second trace here, so that comes out of these two guys, right? What we've got is we're swapping particle 3 becomes particle 4, particle 1 becomes particle 2, and instead of the mass of the electron, we have the mass of the muon, which I'm writing here as m mu, because if I use the symbol mu, it will generate a lot of confusion with the index mu here that's got nothing to do with the fact that it's a muon, right? So I'll write out mu to make it clear that we're talking about the muon particle and not an index. So if I take this and I just swap everywhere I see a 3 for a 4, everywhere I see a 2 for, everywhere I see a 1 for a 2, and this becomes the mass of the muon, then I get this expression here for this trace, right? And then the last step, which I can see you're looking forward to with eager anticipation, is that we take this expression here and we multiply it by this expression here, right? And what you're going to be able to see is, so for example here, because these indices are on the bottom, we have these indices are on the bottom here, right? And so when we start multiplying these two terms together, you know, if we multiply this expression with this expression, then for example you'd get a P4 dotted with a P3 dot P4 and a P1 dot P2, right? Because the indices, you've got to take the pair with the matched indices, and one will be up and one will be down, and you have to go through every flaming combination of these two things. Right, so you can see that you're going to end up with something that's not particularly pretty, and so this is what you end up with. Right, all you're doing here is again just multiplying these two terms together, taking all the different combinations, and so these four things here will give you a dot product of four vectors. This will give you dot product of four vectors, and you're putting all the things together, and it's, you know, half a page of algebra to evaluate these things. But everybody's you're happy doing that level of algebra, right? I mean, there's no. When you can see how these expressions multiplied together end up with giving you a dot product, yeah. Yeah. Right, with the repeated in. Well, okay, I'll do it for one so that you can see. Right, so if I take the first term in these two brackets, so it's going to be this term multiplied by this term here, right? So I've got a P3 mu, P1 mu, and in the second term, I've got a P4 mu, P3 nu, right? So I can rearrange these terms here and end up with P3 mu, P4 mu, times P1 mu, P3 mu, right? This term here is just P3 dotted with P4. And this term here is just P1 dotted with P3, right? So if you go through all these pairs, you know, because you can see here the indices are always going to match. You've always got a mu nu for each term up here that's on the top, and for each term down here, you've got a mu nu that's on the bottom, right? If you go through these, you end up with this expression for the average matrix element, the average overall spins of the amplitude squared for electron muon scattering is given by this, right? Now then, this, you also need to remember, is that this is the simplest QED process that we can just about think of, right? Because it only involves a tree level, one diagram. If you have processes that involve two diagrams, then of course, what you're going to end up with is a sum of two matrix elements squared, and the algebra is going to get even worse. So part of the reason for going through this is to just give you an appreciation now of when you go talk to a theorist and they said, oh yeah, well, I whipped up this cross section and here it is. It's not just they sat down one afternoon and scribbled a few lines and came up with a number, right? There is a heck of a lot of work behind this, right? And this is only evaluating, this is, remember, evaluating one Feynman diagram, right? And it's a simple QED level Feynman diagram. And there are theorists now that work on sort of two loop diagrams. So not just leading order, but next to leading order. And they have thousands of diagrams. And in fact, they don't do it by hand anymore like we're doing. They have these state-of-the-art computer algebra programs that will actually do the algebra for them and generate, well, if you go talk to Andrzej Czarnecki or Sasha Penin, because they work on these sort of things, you know, they have algebraic expressions with millions of terms because they've got thousands of diagrams, and each of these diagrams has got, you know, matrix elements like this that, yeah, they have lots of fun. So they actually get computers to solve the algebra for them, because this is clearly non-trivial, right? This is about the simplest level that we go to. And of course, we're still not over, because even though we've now evaluated our amplitude squared, if we want to turn this into something that we can go out and measure on an experiment, right, you then have to stick this into Fermi's golden rule and stick in values for the four momenta for each of these terms and work it through and come out with a measurable quantity, right? So on your assignment, there is one sort of work through of doing a Feynman diagram calculation and getting a matrix element, but there will only ever be parts of the calculation on an exam, because otherwise the exam would have one question, which is calculate the differential scattering for electron muon, the differential cross section for electron muon scattering, and that would take you 3 hours easily, probably longer, to figure it out, right? So, yeah. Yes. Well, you get the cross section averaged over all spins, right? Which of course is what you want if you're scattering unpolarized electrons and muons off each other, which is typically the case, right? I mean, if you've got an typically what you're doing is you've got an unpolarized electron beam and you're bouncing it off a target, where the electrons are, well, probably stationary. So we've gone through this calculation now, and I'll stop there in terms of the calculation. But one of the things we haven't covered, which I will just mention, is that should be a superscript, external photon lines. So the external photon lines, if you look at the Fermi rules for QED, they have these polarization vectors E mu. And if you read through the book, they do some examples with things like positronium decay to two photons. So E plus E minus annihilation, essentially. So, you know, read through the book for examples, because we haven't just got enough time to go through them in the lectures. But these have polarization vectors E mu, and when you put them through the Feynman diagram calculation, you'll end up with traces that now carry sort of slashed versions of these polarization vectors. They have a gamma mu times a epsilon slash. And these, of course, behave just like the momentum vectors here. So, you know, you put in the gamma factor and you take the polarization vector out of the trace. And you treat them as the same way these slash momentum vectors. But unlike the spinner, these are actually real four vectors, right? So a spinner, remember, is not a four vector. This polarization vector comes from our four vector potential from Maxwell's equations, and so it is a four vector. Right, so these are real four vectors. What we're dealing with here for the momenta, when we have these things, well, the momentum vector is a four vector, but these things are not like the spinners. So you can treat these polarization vectors just like the momenta because they're real four vectors. Okay, so we've done a lot of stuff in QED with electrons and muons, but we haven't talked about the other branch of the fermion standard model, which are the quarks. So, for example, we can consider an E plus E minus annihilation here to give us a photon and producing a pair of quarks instead of producing muons or electrons. Now, if we look at this here, although we're initially modeling this is a QED diagram, so we're coupling to the charge on the quarks, right? And although these things are going to be initially produced as free quarks, as these things move apart, of course, we talked about confinement, and so what will happen is you'll end up, after this interaction, a sort of a string of gluons will develop between these quarks, and either what will happen is the quarks will snap back. They'll either snap back and form a meson state, or in fact, what's far more likely, unless this thing's sitting on resonance, which is what you'd require for this thing to produce a meson state at rest, what is more likely is that these things will blast apart and you'll get strings of gluons stretching between them, and these of course will condense and as the gluons stretch and the energy gets stored in the strong field, it'll eventually be energetically favorable to collapse that field by producing quark-antiquark pairs. And so what will actually happen is as these two quarks move apart, they will go through a process called hadronization, where the strong field collapses into a shower of quarks and antiquarks, and these all bind together to form baryons and mesons. And so what you end up with is a shower of particles following the momentum of this quark and a shower of particles following the initial momentum of this antiquark. And so in a detector, if this is at high energy, you will end up with a shower of jets of hadronic particles. And the hadronization process is non-perturbative QCD, and nobody can actually calculate what goes on. In fact, this is one of the problems with Monte Carlos, is Monte Carlo simulations can't actually simulate this hadronization very accurately because they just sort of parameterize it and make it match the measured quantities in data. So if we go through this, this is just a simple QED Feynman diagram, and if we go through this, these are the constants we get out of the front, where Q now is the quark charge in units of the electron charge. So if these are up like quarks, then it'll be plus 2/3, and if they're down like quarks, Q here will be minus 1/3. So this is what the matrix element will look like, and now, so we have this extra Q factor in here, but the rest of this is just like it would be for electrons, E plus E minus going to mu plus mu minus. The only change here is this factor of Q in the front, because the quarks have got a fractional charge. If these were muons, then this would be 1. Right? So I'm not going to go through the derivation of that. This is just comes from applying the Feynman diagrams, the Feynman rules straight to this diagram. And you can see, though, you get the same sorts of structures that you'd expect. So again, I'm not going to go through the details here because we did it for electron muon, but it's exactly the same. You've got these terms here with 2 and 1 now. It's not, because of course we've got a different structure. Here we were dealing with a T channel, here we've got an S channel, so it's 1 and 2 that are related, and 3 and 4, and here we had 1 and 3 and 2 and 4, right? So we're going to end up with a slightly different thing here because we've got P1 and P2 in one trace and P4 and P3 in the other trace. The other difference is we've got antiparticles. Now, this is why we label these things with Vs for antiparticles and Us for particles, because when we're doing the completeness relationship here, for the Us, for the particles, we end up with the standard Feynman diagram, the standard Dirac equation, and this gives us a plus. But for the antiparticles, remember, these are negative energy solutions to the Dirac equation, and so what you find is you end up with a minus term in here, right? So for the antiparticles, the completeness relationship gives you this negative sign. For particles, you get a positive sign. So, and here we've got MQ for the quark mass. So again, we can go through, we can evaluate these traces, and I'm skipping over all the horrible algebra because we've already done it for the electron muon case. Again, it's exactly the same type of algebra, it's just some of the indices are moved around now. And so we get a different series of dot products, right? And so these are the things we end up with here for the dot products of the four momenta. And again, we've got this Q factor. And so now we can start talking about cross-sections. So we've got a matrix element here. We can put this into the Fermi's golden rule, and that will give us a differential cross-section. And then we can integrate that differential cross-section over all allowed solid angles, which of course will depend on your detector. But in the textbook, they just integrate this over all possible solid angles in the assumption they've got an idealized perfect detector. The details of how to do this are on page 277 in Griffiths. It's just the same thing that we've been doing here, but you're just taking the next logical step, which is sticking the matrix element into Fermi's golden rule, putting in the fact that you're in the center of mass frame, that you've got E plus E minus coming in with equal and opposite momenta, and then you're evaluating through Fermi's golden rule, right? So it's not complicated, there's no magical physics, but it is a horrible load of algebra, right? And this is, in fact, the one sort of thing that I always sort of think gets in the way of the beautiful theories behind particle physics is that, you know, in order to calculate them and see how wonderful they are, you have to go through this, you know, sludge of algebra, which is why I'm an experimentalist and not a theoretician. Because then you can just concentrate on the nice results that the theoreticians have calculated and say, oh, isn't the physics beautiful? And you don't have to worry too much about this. I mean, you need to know, obviously, how to do this, but you don't look at it too often, thank goodness. So you've calculated your matrix element. You stick your matrix element into Fermi's golden rule, integrate over all solid angles, and end up with a total cross-section that looks like this, right? Because you can see in the end, you get nice results. So, and also we're assuming here that the energy of the incoming electron positrons is a lot larger than the mass of the quarks, right? So this is how this thing simplifies. So we're taking the ultra-relativistic limit. And if you want to know the details of how to get this, page 277 in Griffiths has all of the beautiful algebra. Anyway, so this is the result we get. So we can look at this. So what this is telling us is that the cross-section here goes as 1 over the energy squared, where energy here is the energy of one of the incoming electron or positron beams. And this is what experimentally we see. So this is straight out of the particle data group from 2010. This is the measured electron-positron cross-section in millibarns. So this is the total cross-section. And you can see a general trend as it decreases with increasing energy, which is exactly what we'd expect from here, right? So it decreases. Now, you may also notice that there are these sort of spikes every so often. Well, what I did say when we were doing the calculation, I was skipping over the calculation, was that we were assuming that these two quarks were going to move apart and that they weren't going to sort of bound back together and form a single meson, that we were producing two jets of particles. Well, of course, what happens is if you've got your electron-positron pair with just the right amount of energy, that it sits, that the invariant mass of the incoming electron-positron is exactly equal to the rest mass energy of a meson, then what will happen is the two quarks that you produce won't produce showers of particles. They will end up in a bound state producing one of these mesons. And when that happens, you're sitting in a resonance condition, and you get a huge increase to the cross-section. So when you assume, when we do this calculation here, we're not assuming any sort of resonance, any quark resonance in the states that we're producing. We assume that we produce two free quarks, and that those quarks then hadronize very, very rapidly, of 10 to the minus 25 seconds, and produce jets of particles. But this does not always happen, so if you're sitting about 3 GeV, you can produce a J-psi resonance, or slightly higher here, you can produce a BB bar resonance, and you get all these big sort of resonance states here. But notice it's only when you've got a quark-antiquark pair, right? So this is psi, remember, if you remember from the midterm, this is the S-S bar resonance, charm-anti-charm, B-anti-B, and top anti-top would be way off here, but then you wouldn't really expect to see a resonance because there's no bound top quark states. This resonance here is something different, and you can see that it's different because these are very, very narrow, and this guy is really wide. And this is where, instead of a photon being what you produce when you annihilate the electron-positron, here you produce a Z boson because you've got enough energy. This is the invariant mass of the Z boson at 90 GeV. And so here you get a different type of resonance. Instead of a QED process, you have a weak interaction process. So what we can do is we can calculate the ratio of electron-positrons going to hadrons, so these showers of particles, versus the ratio of electron-positrons going to muons, which is what we've sort of calculated already, right? It's just a revamping of this diagram. And what this will, if we're producing free quarks, we can use this to measure the number of quark types that we can produce, right? Because if we take this ratio here, we can just, the only difference, we look at this here, the only difference between an electron or producing a muon or a quark is that for a muon, this is going to be one. For a quark, this is going to have some charge, and there's also going to be some number associated with it. So if we calculate this resonance here, then this is where Q is equal to one, and so what we're going to end up with is just the sum of all of these Q terms squared, right? Where this is the total number of different quark flavors that we can produce, and this three here comes because there are three colors. So we can produce a red quark, a blue quark, or a green quark. And this is, in fact, measuring this ratio means that we can actually experimentally determine the number of yellow, the number of colors, right? So if there was a yellow quark flavor, right, this would be four. And so we'd actually see a bigger value for the ratio, and we'd know that there are actually four colors of quarks, or five or six or whatever. But the best fit to the data is with three colors. And so this is one way that we can determine the number of different quark colors. And then the number of quarks that we can produce depends on the energy of the beam, right? Because the mass of the quark has got to be less than or equal to half the total energy available in the center of mass of the system. So with a low energy, you're only going to produce UD and S quarks, and so you get a ratio of 2. If you go above the charm quark threshold, the ratio will increase to 3 because charm has got a charge of 2/3, so it's got quite a large electrical charge. And then if you go up to B quarks, it increases, but only by a small amount because the B quark has only got a charge of 1/3, right? And so this is also another way that we can actually measure the charge on the quarks and confirm that when we go to the charm quark, it has got a charge of 2/3 and not 1/3. And so if we measure this ratio now, so this is now the ratio, not the cross-section, it's the ratio. And although it's sort of polluted by these resonances and then weird, crazy effects down here, you can at least see it for the charm and the B, right? So you can see that here we've got something that's relatively flat, and then it jumps up. And this is the charm quark threshold. And then we go along with the charm quark, and it jumps up, and we can produce the B quark threshold. And this is actually a way that we can measure the mass of the quarks by looking at these threshold effects. And in fact, the studies will give us a far more accurate measure of the top quark mass if we build this next linear collider with a linear E plus E minus beams that can actually produce TT bar. And then you can use the turn on as this ratio changes around the 340 GeV, which is what you need to produce two top quarks, and then you can actually get a very, very, a far more accurate measurement of the top quark mass than we've currently got from hadron colliders. So it's also useful for measuring masses, but obviously, as you can see around here, the zoomed in pictures, if you look in the PDG, it's not quite as complicated as the nice simple picture that we've been presenting in our diagram. And so this dotted line is sort of the simple quark model, and this red line is when you start adding in higher order loop corrections. And so things get more complicated, right? So it's not as simple as we've been making out, but nevertheless, it's almost the same. You can see a little jump here for bees and a big jump for charm. Okay, so our simple calculation here, the reason for this difference is we've been assuming free quarks, and correcting away from that is not simple. Oops, what the heck was that? Okay, so I'm just about done because I'm out of time. Actually, why don't I save this for next time? Well, have I got time to do it now? Do you need to dash? You need to dash. Okay, I'll stop now, and we'll talk about gluons in the next lecture, the discovery of the gluon.